Hello, I'm Mary Hurdle from Made By Marney, and I design paper-pieced patterns. Here's one of my latest designs. It's a snowman block, and I've used it to make this snowman stocking for Christmas. It's going to be part of a new Christmas book that I'm working on, and I thought you'd like to see an easy way to paper-piece a simple block. It's really quite easy. All you need are these simple tools, a nice sharp scissors, some flat head pins, a seam ripper, and a sewing machine. It's also good to have an iron handy, and really that's all you need to get started. I'm going to take my block and make a copy of it. I never want to use my original. I'll take that copy and cut off the extra at the top and the bottom. But I'm going to save the little picture. I like how that shows me all the colors that were used in the original, and it helps me place things. The rest of this can be thrown away. I'm going to take my block and find number one, because paper piecing is really just stitch by number. I'm starting with shape one, I'm going to stitch on shape two, then three, then four, and five, and so on. In a simple block, all of the pieces are connected at one time in one full block. You don't have to put one part of the block together with another part of the block like you do in a combination block. So this is a really simple pattern. Starting with number one, the little letter next to it, the A, tells me what color I need, and my color code is always right at the top. So A is orange. I find a piece of orange and cut it so that it will be about a half inch bigger than this shape all the way around. And I can easily see if it is by holding it up to a window or a light source, as if I have it pinned on, and make sure it's big enough. The right side of the fabric should be facing away from the paper. Next, I need number two, color B, that's white. And I like to use chunks that are about the size of half of a fat eighth. So here we have a fat eighth that was cut in half. So it's about 9 by 10. And I'm using that to piece on my first color. So I'm going to pin my first color in place, or it's actually my second color, and I pinned it so that when I placed it on, the shape I'm working on, shape number two, is facing to the right. And the remainder of the fabric, the scrap, is facing to the left, right side up. So I'm sandwiching my two pieces together right side to right side. And I just put a little pin there to keep it in place. Or I can just hold it. Honestly, I actually just hold it. Take it to my sewing machine just like that, making sure that the excess fabric of number two's piece, the white, is sticking out about a half inch farther than I need it. And it will go past the shape a little bit, half inch there, and about a half inch there. Well, mine goes quite far. Notice I have not pre-cut anything. I never pre-cut my pieces. I send it through my sewing machine in this direction, so I always know the piece I'm working on is to the right. That way I can see right away, I can do that mental check. Okay, this is the right way I have it laying, because a lot of people get confused. Normally you'd have your fabric right under the piece if you were doing regular sewing, but with paper piecing, it's always the opposite. So I run it through the machine and I sew from here to here, about a quarter inch past the line at the top and bottom. Flip this piece over when I'm done sewing, and if I have a nice sharp scissors and I can cut a straight line, I simply cut off my seam allowance to about a quarter of an inch. Some people like to use a rotary cutter and a ruler for this step. I'd rather just cut it. It goes faster. Now I'm going to flip it. So I take my whole thing and flip it over. I take it to my pressing board and I flip my piece over. And this is called the butterfly effect. So now I'm going to put it to this side and actually have to make sure that there's enough fabric here to cover piece number two. Press it. And now I'm going to trim. So if I just pull this piece up a little bit and trim about a half inch away from that line, and I'm just eyeballing it, and the same thing here, about a half inch away. Now I have a piece for number two that fits under there perfectly, and I didn't have to pre-cut anything. And I like those flathead pins to just kind of keep those pieces down, especially if they're large. This is not wasted. It's going to be used again and again and again. And if it gets really ratty, I'll trim some off to get a nice straight edge on it and just keep using it till it's all gone. I'm ready for piece number 3. Remember, the piece I'm working on is going to the right. My scrap is going to the left. I lay it in position. I might even want to pin it. And make sure that you have enough fabric going past about a half inch, past the line. You'll be sewing between number 1 and number 3. If you just go in order of the numbers, you should be fine. Sew a quarter inch past the line at the beginning and the end. You don't have to back tack. This seam will be hidden later anyway. Take it to my cutting board, or I just actually do this on my ironing board. And did you see how I had to rip that little seam flat? Sometimes if that seam goes into your new seam line, you just pop it down. And now I'm trimming. Quarter of an inch. About. And then I do my flip. Flip it. And press it. And then after pressing, I'm ready to trim my piece. So again, I just fold it up gently so I have about a half inch all the way around that shape. And again, no pre-cutting necessary. I'll keep going until I've gotten to number 11. That's my last piece. And I'm on it right now. It's a green piece. I've already sewn it. I went into all the way into my seam allowance areas to get quarter inch past this sewing line. Now I'm going to pop all those seams flat, those little tiny quarter inch seams that were going in perpendicularly, before I do my trimming. And then I will trim off the extra. Press it, and I like to trim from this side so I can see where my piece is. Then my block is ready to be squared up. And that's the fun part. To square it, I lay it on my cutting board. And I'm going to lay it on, this is the back of the block, I'm going to lay it on so I'm looking at the paper side. And you see the little dotted lines? In a perfect world, I should be able to just take my scissors and cut on that dotted line and I'd get that perfect 8x8 square, but it's not a perfect world. So I'm going to use my ruler, and I'm using the line here to line up my ruler with that dotted line, and I try to get it squared, and then I'm going to cut it with my rotary cutter. So eventually it's nice to have that cutting board, the ruler, and your rotary cutter. So I would cut it on that side, line that up really perfectly. Then I can go to this side, make sure I'm on the 8-inch mark over here. So I'm really using my lines to square it. So I'm not looking so much at the dotted lines as I am at the numbers on my cutting board. And so it's 8 that way, and then I'm going to do the same going in this direction. Then it's ready to be put into a project. And before I rip off my paper, I would actually sew on the side pieces for my stocking or whatever my direction calls for. If I'm doing a potholder and there is nothing to put around the edge, then I can go ahead and rip my paper off right now. Otherwise, it's better to put your sashing on and then do your ripping. I can also do my stitching. If there's any embroidery, now is a great time to do it because the picture is here. And my embroidery I'm going to be doing from the back. So my knots are on the back. I start back there and then I just do my embroidery following those lines. I don't like to sew my buttons on until I've added any kind of fusible fleece, if I need fusible fleece, because buttons are a little hard to iron over. So those I tend to put on later, and anything big and bulky I sew on at the end. And that's all for today. And this has been Made by Marney, Mary Hurdle, and I'll see you next time. Bye.